Good morning. Welcome to the talk, DevSecOps, What, Why, and How. And our speaker today is Anant Shrivastava. And we're in the South Pacific, so if that makes sense to you, you're in the right place. Awesome. So before we begin, just a few brief notes. So stop by the Business Hall located in Mandalay Bay, Oceanside, and Shoreline Ballrooms on Level 2. The Black Hat Arsenal is in the Business Hall on Level 2. Lunch is in Bayside AB down on the ground floor from 1 till 2:30. And don't forget the merchandise store on level 2 and session recordings from SOK. So as a quick reminder, please make sure your phone is on vibrate. That makes it so much nicer for everybody. But without further ado, please join me in providing a warm welcome to our speaker, Anant Shrivastava.
Good morning, everyone. So the topic that we have for today is DevSecOps, What, Why, and How. I'll give a quick introduction about myself. I'm Director, Not So Secure Global Services. I started my career as a system administrator, moved on to a bit of development, and for past couple of years, I'm fully into information security domain. Been trainer and speaker at a bunch of different conferences. I also like to run a couple of open source projects. My Twitter handle and other details are there. Let's dive into the actual topic at hand. So the agenda for today is to start with what is DevSecOps, why do we need DevSecOps, how do we actually go about starting with DevSecOps, what kind of tool chains that we can use, is there some kind of a setup that we can get started with, some sample implementations, and one or two case studies around it. So a quick disclaimer here. I'll be talking about a lot of tools. There'll be multiple tools that I'll be referencing. I am not recommending those specific tools. I am not saying that that's the all list in the world. There will be more tools available. I've tried to focus on open source tools, but there could be more tools available. So I'm not endorsing any of the tools. I am not saying it's the exhaustive list. However, this is the list that I found useful and I've experimented around with. Another thing to keep in mind is, and this is something that you will realize as you deep dive into DevSecOps, every environment is going to be different. There is no one size fit all. You can't take someone's DevSecOps practices and as is templately implement it into your own organization. You will have to play around with it. You will have to tweak things around, and then only you'll be able to have your own DevSecOps setup. Now, what is this DevSecOps? DevSecOps is basically a process or an effort where you're trying to be secure by default. How do you achieve a secure by default state? You can start with integrating security via tools. You can start with creating security as a code culture. And you need to start promoting cross-skilling. Instead of having three different teams doing three different jobs, Dev, Sec, and Ops, you need one unified team which can basically take care of all the three components. That's the aim that we have for DevSecOps. Now, why do we need DevSecOps? DevOps, which came up with dev and operations combining together, performing rapid development deployment. The problem with that is security in traditional form cannot keep up. When you talk about security, when you talk about, say, let's take pen testing for an example. For an application, the pen testing might take 3 days, 4 days, 5 days. That's the usual setup you get. But when you're deploying maybe 20 times a day, you can't afford to have 3 days or 4 days time for pen test. You need to get those things done at a rapid pace. And that's where DevSecOps comes into picture. It makes it easier for you to have security a part of your process, a part of your pipeline. And that's the only way going forward. If you want to keep pace with rapid development, you have to have security as part of the process, not as an end point or an end goal after a certain number of steps. So conventionally, this is how a normal DevOps cycle looks like. You start with a developer developing a code, putting into code repository, build servers kicking in, using CI/CD, maybe a staging deployment, then production deployment. You have monitoring piece around it. Around that time is when people realize, hey, I may also need to have security testing done. So security testing comes into picture, and then they perform certain actions, and then you move forward with that. However, the problem here is, let's say a bug is found at the last stage. By the time the bug is reported back to the actual developer, they might have moved on to a different module. They might have started working on something else entirely different. The time required to get back into the groove of that specific code block, work towards mitigating the issue, and then moving forward with it, that's a big amount of time that you're investing in. Whereas, if you shift this slightly, let's say around build step, you do automated source code review. And for example, one SQL injection is found. As soon as that is found, this step is something that happens very, very close to developer. As soon as developer has committed the code, it goes to the build process, automated code review happens. As soon as that happened, you found a bug, got reported. Instead of wasting time in the other processes, you immediately started towards mitigating it. And on the parallel side, there is one safety feature that comes up. Because there was an error, the build did not proceed, there was no deployment that happened. So you are safe from that bug getting exposed to public. Now, how do we go about doing DevSecOps? Now, I'm going to talk about lots of tools, automation, but automation is one part of the process. You cannot have DevSecOps until and unless you accept that as a culture and you move towards making that a ground reality in your organization. I'll talk about culture in some time. Initially, I'll basically be talking about how do you go about injecting security in your DevOps pipeline. So I've taken the same pipeline that we had and I've added security components on it at each stage. Right from developer trying to write secure code, you can have pre-commit hooks or IDE plugins which can help them spot basic bugs to pre-build where you can perform SAST, DAST, and other steps to QA staging, production, and all the data getting together into vulnerability management. Now, in terms of Jenkins, this is how a pipeline looks like. The top one that you see is the DevOps pipeline. And in that same pipeline, below I have added DevSecOps sections. Now, I'm going to talk about each of these sections quickly, and then we'll move forward towards a demo where we see all these in action. So I talked about pre-commit hooks. This is a step which would help you in spotting errors and especially helping you not to leak credentials. There have been multiple instances where a developer has committed their AWS keys, or a developer went on and pushed username passwords in GitHub repositories, which were publicly accessible and were abused in larger breaches. If you want to protect yourself against this, this could be one step. You can write regular expression patterns, and you can use codes which will be working like pre-commit hooks. Now, the important thing to remember here is, this is not going to be a final solution. This is one layer in the onion. The pre-commit hook happens at the developer workstation. If the developer wants, they can break that chain, they can bypass pre-commit hook and move forward. So you can't consider this as, I have done this, I am done with this part. You will still have to look for things, but it acts as a deterrent. You get that initial warning, people get an idea, accidental damage will not happen. Now, IDE security plugins, again, you can have plugins pre-installed in your IDE environment. They will not be able to spot complex issues. You will not get like a third level SQL injection via an IDE plugin. But what you can spot is very basic mistakes. If in PHP you are echoing a GET parameter, that's a straightforward exercise right then and there. That can be spotted. If you're using MD5 algorithm as a algorithm in your code, that can be spotted out that yes, this is a problem. So easy bugs that can be spotted very quickly, that can be done via an IDE security plugin. The idea is not to find all bugs, but rather assist the developer in not making mistakes. Things that could be easily countered, you can get the idea, move on with it. Now, secrets, I talked about that you can stop the developer from pushing secrets in, but then where do they keep the secret? So you need to have some sort of a secret management interface. Hopefully with your DevOps pipelines, you would already have some sort of a secret management, maybe Vault, maybe AWS Secret Manager, one or the other secret management you might be using. You have to ensure that you keep using it for the entire code base. Now, software composition analysis is an interesting aspect. All of us talk about that we develop softwares. Effectively, we write maybe 10% or 20% of that software. All other part is basically imports and references and other modules that we have used. These are all third-party code that we are using. And that generally becomes like the major factor of attacks, the major factor of vulnerabilities. All the newer languages, be it Python, be it PHP, Perl, Ruby, Node.js, Go, everyone provide module options. These modules are written by maybe a corporate company, maybe a company which is backing and maintaining it. Maybe someone thought that, hey, writing this is cool, so I'll write this one module and forgot about that they have uploaded this particular module. In such scenarios, it becomes difficult to identify whether the module is actually being managed or not. Is there a security issue in it? This is the part where software composition analysis comes into picture. You look at the list of third-party modules that you're using, and in those modules, what kind of vulnerabilities might be present? You may have vulnerable modules, you may have outdated modules, you may have discarded modules. All the three possibilities are present. Now, once we have looked at, say, what is the problem with our third-party components, now we need to look at what is the problem with our own code. So that brings us to static analysis of security testing, or SAST. This is basically where you go about run an automated code review tool, and which will be able to pick out easy wins like SQL injection, easier SQL injections, say cross-site scripting, any specific low-hanging fruits will be very, very easily caught at this stage. These tools, again, would be very massively painful to use if you're using them for the first time. I've seen source code review tools churning out maybe reports ranging from 500 to 900 pages on the first run, but the important part with the static code review tools is you need to train them. They are generic in nature. They don't have specific context around your application. So you need to train them, run a couple of iterations, identify what they are picking as false positives, mark them out, and then once you've optimized the tool, maybe 4 or 5 iterations down the line, that's when you start getting the real gem of findings. So with static analysis, what I've seen is people use one tool, find there's lots of false positive. Okay, I don't want to use this tool. Go to another one, keep using it. Again, same result, go to the third one, and they end up digging smaller holes, whereas they could have just used one tool and dig a well. Now, once you've looked at static components, there are still pieces which cannot be found with static components. That's where you need dynamic analysis. Runtime application, once it is deployed, may have different behavior than what you predicted by looking at the source code. Depending on environmental settings, there might be different issues that can crop up. Secondly, you can also use the DAST stage as a validation for your SAST stage. You can take these two and provide feedback to each other. If SAST stage says there's a bug which DAST is not finding, that's a problem. You need to figure out what is wrong. You need to report it to the tool author and get that sorted. Inverse is also possible. DAST picks up something, SAST has not. So you can again look back what is wrong, and you can correct the two stages between each other. Now, once you've done these bits of pieces, that's when you get down to the point where you want to deploy the application into an environment. I am hoping with DevOps culture in place, people will already have infrastructure as code. which means you are not going ahead creating an Ubuntu or Microsoft Windows VM and then configuring everything by hand. You have scripts available, you have automated solutions which you just directly refer, and based on those solutions, your entire environment is set up in one shot. If that's the case, you have a very easy win available because your infrastructure is now in form of a code. As code, you can do static analysis over it. You can do linting, you can check what could be the potential problems just by looking at that code. The other angle that comes up is, most of the times now it's cool and hip to use Docker and Kubernetes. So you would end up using those kind of containerized environments. When you use containerized environments, the bugs that you will find will be centered around the base images that you're using. There are multiple open source studies pointing that all the base images that are generally available on Docker Hub, they have multiple CVEs open on them. Those images, you need to know what are the problems inside them. The thing that people don't publicize about it is, yes, there are maybe 100 CVEs open on it, but those 100 may not be contextually relative to the current environment. So that context is something that is missing in most of the review tools, but if you get started with those reviews, you get the idea. Again, the same approach what we did with SAST. You take that input, filter it out, understand it, and then make decisions based on it or add them into exceptions that, hey, these things I'm not worried because they are not contextually sensitive to my environment. However, if you make that call, if you make a call that in my environment this is not required, but other environments it might be a vulnerability, you need to ensure whenever your environment changes, whenever your setup changes, you go back and revisit that and see, hey, I made a call at one point that this is not contextually relative. Is it now contextually relative? And you have to keep making that call whenever you go about changing the environment. Now, some of the organizations have to follow certain compliance. Some of the organizations don't have specific compliances, but then you may want to follow certain benchmarks. So in that scenario, again, you can have compliance built in as code. You can write scripts which, and you can, you have multiple tools available which allow you to write those scripts which can embed your compliance structure within the code. And then you can keep it within your repository, manage it. Whenever new compliance checks are required, add it. And those can be tested again and again. Now, I talked about a bunch of different stages. All of these stages are going to generate reports, which means yet another document to read. And that is something no one likes. Neither security likes it, neither dev likes it, neither ops like it. I think there's no one in the industry who would like to read a whole bunch of documents. So you need a central place where you can manage these documents, and that's where vulnerability management comes into picture. This piece of software can be placed between your bug tracking system, which your developers are very familiar with, and your security tools. So you feed in all of your security data into this one tool, and then use this tool like your central dashboard, filter out things for dev, and then push the right things in. This process initially would be something that a security team has to do, but later on, the way it should move forward is everyone needs to get an understanding and everyone can start exploring those options. Now, once you have an environment deployed and you are running everything in pipeline, feels like my job is done. That's where your job has actually started. Once you have deployed your pipeline for the first time, that's when you start looking for feedback. You have done a bunch of steps. How do you know that it actually worked? How do you validate that it actually worked? So that's where alerting and monitoring will come into picture. You can keep monitoring your environment, see if an attack is happening or if someone is trying an attack. If they are trying an attack, are they getting success? If they are getting success, there is something wrong. If they are not getting success, you have succeeded in deploying some safety precautions. Again, the whole assumption, everything is hacked, everything can be hacked, all goes hand in hand, but you can still make life miserable for the attacker. And that's the aim. Now, another point which people keep forgetting about, and I just wanted to quickly touch base on this, the assets. When we talk about assets, we generally talk about, yeah, I have these many servers, and that's about it. People don't realize right now we have reached a point where your GitHub repositories are your assets, your social media profiles are your assets, every single cloud objects that you have published online, they are your assets. They may not be on-prem, they may not be in your control. Every developer or ops or an admin person who has a valid credit card can start and spin up instances at their own will. All of those, if they are running softwares related to your environment, they are part of your assets. Because ultimately, if a compromise happens, it will affect the organization. So you need to keep monitoring these assets. Again, I'll talk about how you can go about monitoring these assets. So without taking a lot of time, I'm going to quickly jump into a simplistic flow. So what we've done here is we've taken Java as an application. And for Java application, we have deployed the entire DevSecOps pipeline. So I'm going to run a quick video. Instead of waiting for all the steps to finish, I've just compressed everything in a video, and I'll try and explain you through the video. So you can see these are the various stages that we have added in the DevOps pipeline. Now, this was the same diagram that I showed you earlier. We had a DevOps pipeline, and we added protections in terms of DevSecOps pipeline. Now, stage zero, because this is not going to be part of the pipeline. This is something you have to do before pipeline comes into picture. So I'm a developer. I have pushed an AWS secret key into one of these files. As soon as I tried to make a push, this was detected that, hey, there is some sort of a secret or hex encoded value. You may want to revisit what you're doing. So this regular expressions, you can write your own, and those could then be part of the process. The tool that we used for this is called Talisman. Now, for software composition analysis, we are using OWASP dependency checker. Again, there are hundreds of options available. This one was easier to use, so that's what we used. So at this point, I have just pushed a fresh code piece, and that has caused a build. As soon as the build happened, the SCS stage picked up 38 high severity vulnerabilities in the pipeline. Now the bug that I commented out in the snippet refers to Struts version. This was the same version which was responsible for Equifax breach. I think few of you might remember the exact version number also. So this was the exact version that was in Equifax, resulting in a breach. Now I've updated the version to a slightly newer version. And now this was an intentional thing that I've kept high severity, 5 high severity vulnerabilities. I am still going to pass this build. The reason being, I wanted to emphasize on the fact that, hey, we all aim for having zero bugs in the code. The ground reality is you may never reach that position, or you may reach that position maybe very long in the chain. So you need to accept that, yes, I may have bugs in the code. I have to live with those bugs. I will aim to fix those, but may not be today. So you may have to move forward with it, which is what we are doing here. We are accepting the risk that, yes, 5 bugs are there. In this particular context, the libraries are vulnerable, but they're contextually not relative to the code that we have. So we are allowing those. Now for SAST stage, we are using another Java-based software called FindBug. And again, if you look, there is one high severity vulnerability that is detected, which we have had a requirement, and we are asking the build to fail at this point. Now, this is a crude way of fixing it. I'm not actually trying to do any sort of fix. I basically removed the section of code. I hope no developer will ever do this, but yeah, for demo purposes, I had to just write a quick wrapper. So right now you can see there are two files that we have changed, and we are pushing the update. And this time, the same stage gives me zero high severity bugs. That's my condition. So now I'm moving forward with this stage. Now, dashed stage gets very tricky. Any dynamic analysis software worth your salt will not be able to finish a scan in maybe a minute or 2 minutes. They will need more time. And that is why in this particular pipeline, we have taken a slightly different step. What we have done is we have started a dynamic scan. We have deployed the application in a QA environment, and we have started the scan, but we have not paused the pipeline for it. The scan will run, will finish, and will send us an email notification that, yes, I'm done. These were the results. But for that, we are not pausing the pipeline. Why? I'll come to that in a few minutes. Why not pausing the pipeline is important? I'll come to that in a minute. So right now, the scan is running. Once the scan was finished, I got an email saying, hey, this is done. These are the number of vulnerabilities that are present. Now, Clear software that we're using here for infrastructure scan, this is basically looking at all the Docker images that we have in the environment. It is running scan against all these images and telling us if there is any specific vulnerability in it. I had to use an open source infrastructure scanning tool, and the only tool that I could find working nicely was OpenVAS. So we have OpenVAS here. Using OpenVAS, we are running scans against the deployed images. Again, it'll take time. So again, the same procedure is followed. We delay the execution, or rather we sidetrack the execution. The execution works on its own time. And once it is done, you get an email notification. Now for compliance, we are using InSpec, which is a tool available where you can create a compliance script. And that compliance script can then take up all the checks that you wanted to proceed. Here we have used CIS benchmarks for Apache Tomcat. And you can see there are a bunch of benchmarks which have passed, which has, there are few which has failed. And we had a threshold number. It matched the threshold number. So we were able to push the build forward. Now in the pipeline, what we had was a manual approval. This is equivalent to saying, yes, the build is done, the artifact is here. Now another build process will kick in when all the tests are done on this process, on this particular build ID, and then the deployment will happen in production. But I wanted to show everything in one shot. So I've had a manual stop here. So we need to manually approve it. Once it is approved, it gets deployed to production. Again, once the app is deployed, you can also automate the WAF deployment on top of the web application. And these WAF, right now, what we've done is we've made an email notification because we were following email notification as a policy. But this email notification is just a trigger, which could be anything like a Slack alert, like a pager if you are still using one, any other tool that you want to use where webhooks are possible, you can have webhooks attached and provide these. Or what you can do is, if you feel like it'll be overwhelming number of notifications that you'll be getting, you can have, say, digests for, say, a whole day with a condition that, hey, if a certain threshold is reached, do not create a digest, but rather directly send me an email that, hey, something went wrong. But other than that, create a digest, send me a digest once in a day. Now for all these scans that we were running, Zap that we started, OWASP, OpenVAS that we started, both of these were started via our vulnerability management tool, which is what you can see right now on screen. This is DevSec that we are using. It's an open source vulnerability management suite. It allows you to pull in results from a whole bunch of scanners. And here you can see there are some scanners that we used. So we were able to pull the results from those scanners. Other scanners we did not use, but they are, if you have reports, you can pull those reports in, and the tool is going to display all of that to you. So dynamic scan, static scan. With static scan, we have kept the commit ID as your reference. So you can see for each commit, what were the number of issues found. And it can also correlate and tell you what was duplicate, what are the new findings, and you can move forward with that. So that was a quick demo around how DevSecOps pipeline was incorporated in an on-prem environment. Now, I said that I'll be talking about a lot of tools. So this is a small list of tools, mostly open source. We are not recommending any one of them, but all of them can work in those specific spaces. And again, some more set of tools. Because yes, open source, multiple tools are possible. I am not saying that there are no commercial solutions, but I am focusing more on open source solutions. Now, I've given you maybe 50, 60 different tools. How do you pick which one do you want to use? So that's where comes the criteria. What are the criteria to be part of the pipeline? The tool should have API and command line access. So it should be programmable, scriptable. The tool should be executing within a maximum threshold time of 15 minutes. Now, to be honest, everyone keeps on saying 15 minutes or 10 minutes. There is no standard. There is no thumb rule. All that matters is the pipeline should finish as early as possible. The ideal state would be the tool does not take even a minute, even a second, and it's just added in the pipeline without any change required. But that's not going to happen. So what you are looking for is the tool can finish the scan in as smaller time amount as possible. Now, the funny part that comes with the tools is if you're buying commercial tools, you will have restrictions. Now, these restrictions are funny. Let's say we are talking about deploying an app in a staging environment and running a certain scan. Now, for staging environment deployment, if you have custom URLs per deployment, you end up counting those as different instances of applications or maybe different applications, depending on the license agreement that you have with the vendor. Now, the vendor may have given you that, hey, you can run scans against 500 applications unlimited number of times, but they are detecting application by URL. So by the time your 500 builds are done for one application, you are out of licenses. So that is one thing that you need to be very, very aware of. What are the limitations? Is there any parallel scanning limitation? Is there a limitation on threads? That is going to be your hindrance. Now, output formats, obviously, you are putting them as part of the whole piece of puzzle. You don't want textual outputs. You want output which can be fed into the next system, preferably JSON. If JSON is not the new thing that they want to work on and they still want to keep the older stuff, I hope they would support XML. So XML and JSON are the preferred options, but do not go with a tool which is just giving you command line output. Just some pluses and minuses in the output may not be the right approach for a tool within a pipeline, until and unless you sit down and write a wrapper around it to make it machine readable. Now, every tool has false positives, false negatives. You want to take those into picture. False positives, you may want to have exceptions around them. The tool needs to have the capability so that you can configure and add things in. Now, pipeline, again, because we are going to add a bunch of these tools, we will end up with a situation where the pipeline is taking a lot of time. So you want to tweak that around. You want to optimize the pipeline. What you can do is you can have multiple parallel pipelines. You can have one pipeline which runs on every commit. You can have another pipeline which maybe runs once in a day. another pipeline which runs when a major commit happens or when a branch is created, and on that branch you have committed a code. So you can have different conditions on which you want different pipelines to be executed. Like I've given a couple of other optimization examples. If there is only CSS change, if you've, all you've done is changed red to black, there is no point running secure code the software composition analysis, static code analysis, dynamic code analysis. That's not going to yield any different result. So look at what has changed. Based on that, can you optimize the processes? That could be one way. However, this does not discount that overall multiple smaller changes can have bigger impact. So you need to ensure that you run non-optimized, which is the full pipeline, every few maybe hours, maybe days, but you need to run those full pipelines periodically. Now, does programming language matters? Depending on different language, all that is going to change is your tool of choice for software composition analysis and static analysis. Those are the two pieces that will have different tool requirements. Again, different languages have different set of tools available that you can play around with. Again, preference is given to open source. I have intentionally avoided any product which is kind of a paid product. Now, these are again reference implementations. The only change that I've done is based on language in use, different set of tools are in use. So you have Ruby here, you have PHP here, you have Python here, you have Node.js here. Different tools for different languages, the only two components are changing, rest all can just be the same piece. That brings me to the next part, which is, what about if you're using cloud? When you have cloud, besides your usual attack surface, you have three more areas to worry about. The identity and access management, because frankly speaking, that's one area which no cloud vendor is going to take care of. That's your responsibility. You need to manage that. The second piece is the asset inventory. Because like I was saying, anyone with a credit card can basically spin up instances in cloud. You need to have a tab on that. You need to know what is happening. The third thing is billing. A lot of attacks could just be billing attacks. They're not going to do any harm to you. All they want is to mine some bitcoins. They would get access to your network, spin up some high capability instances, Bitcoin, Dogecoin, whatever coin they want to mine. They would run a miner on that, and that would keep running, causing you more money. Now, if you have infrastructure as code, it allows you to perform quick audits. You can focus on specific areas like security groups, permissions to various resources, rogue or shadow admins, and forgotten resources. Anyone who has ever used AWS interface would realize there is that drop-down, that dreaded drop-down on the right-hand side, where you have all the regions listed. If you accidentally picked the wrong region and started instances there, you never want to go to that region ever again. But that instance might still be running, may not be patched, may still be hooked up to your network, and may still give access to certain resources. That's forgotten resource. Both the resource as in compute resource-wise, as well as maybe accounts that are created in specific areas, and you're just not taking care of them. All of that could be a problem. Now, let's say, and this is something that we faced a lot recently, where we are dealing with organizations who are fully cloud native. When we were talking about, hey, you can have this and you can have that, their response was, I don't even have an ID on my developer system. They use Cloud9 for everything. So from Cloud9 to the end, it's all cloud native. How do you go about implementing DevOps or DevSecOps in that? So that's where we came up with slight reference implementation. The key components that you have to keep in mind is there are four things: static code analysis, dynamic code analysis, software composition analysis, and vulnerability management, which is something you have to take care of. No vendor is going to take care of that fully. There are some pieces which they're trying to take care of, but you would still have to pitch in and add your own references, add your own tools to go about it. Now, this was a reference implementation that we created. where a developer starts writing code, they have pushed the code to, say, code 9. Code 9 IDE then involves AWS code commit, and then the entire code pipeline kicks into picture. The code build, again, within these pipeline, we can have different stages. Again, software composition analysis, SAST, DAST, all those stages can come in. Now here, what we've done is we have kept two buckets. One bucket is for storing binaries. Another bucket is what we have kept for storing tools. A lot of our tools that we talk about depend on databases. Like OpenVAS needs to have its own database. Dependency checker can only work if it has a proper database. If you download that database every single time, you're wasting your time and you're wasting the pipeline time. So what you can do is you can keep maybe a S3 bucket with all these pre-installed and configured tool set. And whenever you want to use, you just use them from the S3 bucket, or you can have your own internal Docker registry keeping these Docker images ready with all the tools pre-configured inside them and refer them whenever required. But on the other side, keep periodically updating them. So once in a day, you run a scan, you just update all these tools, their definitions, you can just quickly update. And then for the next day, they're up to date and they'll be able to follow through. Within cloud native environment, these are the whole set of tools that you can use. Now I'm gonna quickly show another video. Hopefully it plays out, yep. So I'm running short on time, so I'll do a parallel commentary here. So you can see various stages are there, similar to how we had it in the on-prem environment. Again, you can have Talisman, the same tool that we had earlier. We are able to implement the same tool in Code 9. Again, we'll do the whole, what we say, dance and get things moving. Once a code is built, the build is deployed, build is kept in an S3 bucket, which can then be deployed wherever we want to deploy it. Now, source code analysis, again, we're using OWASP dependency checker. It'll go through the same process, but instead of using Jenkins here, now we are using AWS code pipeline. Similar results because we are using the exact same code base here, but slightly different way of executing it. Again, finds a bug, finds one vulnerability, we'll go ahead, fix that, move forward from that point. And you can see zero high vulnerabilities. Dynamic scan, we are using OWASP ZAP. Again, has its own build. Downloads the scanner, runs the scanner, starts the ZAP CLI mode. And once it is done, you will get the report uploaded into the R3Sec tool that we have. Now for this, what we did was, R3Sec was implemented in a Lambda function. So you don't have to keep that one instance running and you can leverage that. Now here, is the monitoring piece that we are trying to do. So we have taken a situation where an SSH attack happened. Now, what happened? What went wrong? We're just trying to figure that out. This was the vulnerability that was spotted with the AWS inspector. Now we got the compliance part. This was the SSH brute force attack scenario. We're using guard duty, which gave us an information that one IP address is performing SSH brute force attack. So what are they doing? How are they doing? Where they are doing? We'll quickly just see if we can get details about all of that. So now you can see this particular IP address is sending multiple SSH requests. So we'll quickly go in, see if we are even allowing password authentication or not. So you can see Amazon Inspector has reported earlier that for this particular machine, you are allowing password authentication. However, the severity was low. So now we are checking if they actually managed to get a success. So you can see there are multiple invalid attempts. But if you look for valid attempts, you'd find that for one user, they were able to get connected in. Now, scenario two, there's a public S3 bucket. Now, in this scenario, we are using Amazon Macy, and this would basically kick in and spot if we have made a S3 bucket publicly available. So this is the kind of notification that you're getting. And you can have more similar notifications around various scenarios. So you can see the S3 bucket policies has granted read rights to everyone. So this is identified by Macy. So this is where you can see multiple dashboard entries were there, and we were getting multiple alerts regarding various services that were being detected via Macy. And again, all the information can be feeded in into R3Sec, which is running as a Lambda function. Again, you get all the tools that you ran, all the tools can be imported in, and the data is available. And this is what it looks like when you have all these things implemented and running. That brings me to the next aspect, the cultural aspect. I've taken too much time around the DevOps injection of security via tools, because that was the primary focus that I wanted to keep, that within open source space also, you can deploy a lot of these security checks. However, just by deploying security checks, it's not going to work out. The cultural aspect is another key important piece. One thing which security team would not like to listen, but what is a one-liner that I've written at the bottom, the role of a security team in DevSecOps is to eliminate the need of a dedicated security team. You should not have a dedicated security team if you are running a successful DevSecOps environment. You should have people who are specialized in security, but those people should also be part of your one unified team working together with everyone else. If you have one individual just mandated for security, it is not going to work out ever. You need to encourage security mindset across the space. You need to cross-train everyone. You need to build allies. You can only go about discussing things with the other parties if you have allies on the other side. And the important thing is to avoid the blame game. Whenever a bug is found, the first reaction is, who wrote the bad code? The day you get rid of who wrote the bad code part and you focus on, yes, there is a bug, I need to fix this, or we need to fix this, without caring about who actually added that bug, and focusing too much on who added the bug. Focus on the aspect, why this got missed, how we can prevent this, and going forward, how we can ensure no one is able to push that kind of a code in, and we fix this at a much higher level. Now, security champions is the keyword that everyone uses. This is the bridge between DevSec and Ops. Someone in Dev who likes security, someone in Ops who likes security. Till we reach a point where we have one single unified team, we need to find these key people, educate them, help them, incentivize them, and get them to be our mouthpiece in those teams. Now, here, a bunch of different options that I found working for different organizations. One of the options was they picked up single individual and they worked with those individuals. Those individuals were able to get the whole thing moving forward. Another one was you can have internal bug bounties where you incentivize developers to find bugs in their own codes, fix it, move forward. You can have sponsored interactions. Build was deployed successfully, so I would throw a party for the entire development team. It comes from your budget, but it'll help you in interaction. You can sponsor cross-skilling. So if a developer wants to learn secure coding, don't take it from the developer team's budget. Push it from your budget. Shows a good gesture and gives you an ally. People, process, technology, different aspects, different things. In short, you need to have good relationships with between people. Your processes should be as automated as possible with the focus on priority of fixing, not attempting to fix everything. And your technology should be flexible enough that you can move ahead and play around with things. Now, I have a very basic case study here. If struts was found at one point, in usual scenario, you would have picked that flaw whenever the scan ran. Whereas in DevSecOps environment, that scan would be running in 1 or 2 days, and you'd be spotting things then and there. I'm going to keep these case studies here, but I'm not going to go in detail of these. Most of the companies don't talk about their success stories. I was only able to find 2 companies willing to talk about it openly. There was one, Fannie Mae, different results with different implementation techs, but exactly what I talked about, bits and pieces of that was covered here. And ABN AMRO, their own implementation, their own advantages. Things like these, S3 buckets, publicly open, Capital One, bunch of different other incidences, these could have been prevented if you were doing continuous monitoring on your cloud environment. Now, this is not enough. You still need to follow usual bug bounty and pen testing policies, because those would be your feedback loops. They will help you and understand what is going wrong and where you can go about fixing things. The 5 images that I've shown below, they are the 5 top vendors who have claimed that they have some of the best DevSecOps practices, but they still run bug bounties for validation purpose. They keep upping the bug value to ensure that the best mind try their heads around it, but the idea is to get rid of to basically get feedback as much as possible. Last slide around this, when you're deploying security tools, you are deploying a piece of code. Watch the watcher. Have security checks for your security tools. Having admin on a vulnerability management tool is not going to help anyone. And that's something that you need to look for and carefully work towards it. These are a couple of references that I've used, various case studies, various researches that have happened. Those are listed. If you want to take some key takeaways, this is what I would say are the key takeaways for this. Security is everyone's responsibility. Embrace security as part of the process. Use feedback to improve the process. And you cannot take someone else's DevSecOps practices and just templatize it and implement on your own. You have to do your own experimentation. But there's an old saying, your mileage may vary. In DevSecOps, your mileage will most definitely vary. I think that's about it. Thanks a lot for listening.